The main point of advice I'd give is to not rush things. Think about longevity. Learn about the community, who are the OGs, who are the people who have been doing this for a while. Look to them and see what they're doing and respect the community and add value to the community, not just take value from it.
Gentlemen, what's happening? How are you feeling?
¿Qué tal, guys? So good to be back on the podcast. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. We out here. Who we got lined up today, Matt?
Oh, man, I'm very excited. We have got Parrot, who's an incredible 25-year-old artist, multidisciplinary, had a huge collaborative drop on Nifty with Vuocious, Jonathan Wolf, Odious, and has been doing some really cool stuff on his own, too. Also hosts a popular podcast called Origin Stories with Roger Dickerman, has his hands in a lot of things, and is definitely a fixture in the community.
Yeah, no, truly incredible guest. What I personally enjoyed most was hearing how he's really gone about building traction and support within the NFT community. I mean, he started by doing like album artwork and like tour posters, and has since then really gone on to literally be one of the top 50 artists in the NFT world, according to CryptoArt.io. So I think a lot of it is because of his contributions and engagement relationships that he's built in the community. And I think really love how he's able to shine some light to that today. So without any further ado, do you want to get into this week's episode? Parrot. Parrot, what's happening, man? Welcome to the show. How you doing?
Thank you. I'm doing well. Thank you guys for hosting this. I'm excited to talk to you all today.
Oh, likewise, man, for sure. Well, I think just to kind of set the stage, I know you've obviously been kind of a creator and artist for a while, but really kind of curious how you, what kind of got you into the NFT community, and how'd you really kind of continue to snowball some of that support to where you are in the landscape now?
So back in, I think, June of this last year, 2020, I've been a musician for a while. So I've, a lot of my friends in real life are producers, musicians, DJs and stuff. So, and, you know, DJs work pretty closely with visual artists and stuff for festival posters. And that's where a lot of my commissions were coming in. Was festival posters, album art for musicians. But so I was talking to one of my producer buddies, and he was telling me about Glass Crane and how he was on this website called Super Rare, selling his art as something called an NFT, was like able to pay his rent with it, and like really cool technology and this new exciting thing. So I was like, okay, yeah, let me see. Let me go check it out. So I went and checked out Super Rare and kind of like familiarized myself a little bit with what NFTs are. I've been aware of crypto for a while. I'm not really like a finance guy, so it's never really like pulled me in all the way. But I've been aware of like Bitcoin since probably like 2012 or 13 or something like that, and kind of watched it do its thing up to 2017 and Ethereum and all that kind of stuff. So I was like interested in the subject matter of crypto, but when I saw that you could like tokenize art, that kind of sparked something for me, because I'm really interested and bullish of the overall technology of crypto. And now having like, you know, a way to like get my foot in the door in a sense with what I'm passionate about, that really was a cool mix when I found out about it. So I applied to Super Rare. Back then, there wasn't that many people on Super Rare, so I heard back in like 2 days and minted my first piece after that. And I got curious about like what other artists are doing this, and who are these collectors who are collecting this stuff in such a small niche market. So I went onto Twitter and just like followed as many of the collectors and artists that I could that I found on Super Rare. And kind of, I didn't really use Twitter that much before that. So my whole Twitter was just crypto art, and still is, but it was back then too. And so I just started talking to all these people and learning about what this all was, what like the future potential for NFTs were, about how like you can tokenize, you know, all these crazy different things, and about smart contracts and Ethereum. And I don't know, it just really excited me. There was a lot of really cool people there. Still are. Yeah, that's how I found out about it. And then I just kept talking to the same people and meeting new people in the crypto art community on Twitter. Sold my first piece like 2 weeks after I joined, I think, for like $30, which I was just hyped on because it was art that I make anyways, you know. It wasn't like client art that I was uploading. It was just art that I made because I enjoyed. And so the fact that someone wanted to, you know, put value on that was really, really cool for me. Yeah, I just kept at it and made a lot of friends and connections. And, you know, was reaching out to the people who run Super Rare and to talk to them about the market and like all this kind of stuff. Yeah, I mean, it really just blew up in the past few months here, maybe in the past month and a half or so is when everything just went parabolic, as they say.
Talk about shooting your shot and just going into a whole new market and like unseen. I love the organic avenues that you've taken. How have you gone about building support in the community that's helped catapult you to what you are now top 50 artists according to Crypto Art?
Yeah, I don't know, man. I think I'm lucky because when I was in the music scene, I was doing pretty much the same thing in the sense of trying to build a brand around my creations and trying to, you know, network with people like, how can I go play a show in California when I've never been to California before? And I started like doing that, at least like the networking aspect of that in music when I was like 18. So like seven years ago or so. I was like young then, obviously, and inexperienced, and made like a lot of mistakes that I then learned from. But coming into crypto art, it's like the same thing. Like I understood coming in here that like you make friends with everybody and you become part of a community. And you add value to that community. And it's like, that's a very like cut and dry way of looking at it, but it's really organic and fun because like everyone's so freaking cool. And like everyone's super hyped on this idea of NFTs. And I was mind blown that like art was the first thing that was kind of like catapulting NFTs as a whole into the mainstream. Yeah, so I think it was just like experience of me knowing how to build a brand, an excitement to like meet people and bond with people and, you know, start a podcast that I do with Roger and we interview other artists. It's, I think, a combination of all those things. And then just like talking with collectors, becoming friends with collectors and kind of understanding like why they collect art. That was something I had to learn. I didn't really get why someone would collect an NFT at first. You know, I had the same doubts that a lot of people have when they find out about NFTs. Like, you can't hang this on the wall. What's that?
Yeah, to press into that, like, what have you learned about some of the motivators from the collector's perspective?
I've learned that they all have, like, different motivators. Some of them look at it purely from an investment standpoint, where they think they're just really bullish on everything. They think if they can get, you know, a new artist coming into the scene for cheap, at a low price and hold on to that. And it's like, you know, investment 101. As the artist grows, their investment will grow. Some people just have a lot of money and don't know what to do with it and like supporting artists. And some people really like art and like collecting art. And sometimes it's a combination of those things. I was talking to Goltra and he put it very eloquently. I don't know the exact words, but basically all this new money that is happening from tech, from crypto, the people who have that money don't really have any ties to create a cultural impact. Like the old money, they collect traditional art. They do funds and fundraisers and charities and like all this stuff that has a cultural impact. And the new money doesn't really have that access. So what he was saying is it's like this unholy union between this new money and then the creators, and we're building something together that will and does have a cultural impact, which I thought was really cool.
That makes a ton of sense. You know, if you think about it, it's kind of a way for people who have been, you know, successful in these spaces, but somewhat anonymous, to really kind of be able to build an identity in a way that also gives back to that community and can uplift artistry. You know, I loved what we were talking about with the importance of community and collaboration. You know, I know you obviously just recently had a very big drop with Vuocious, Odious, Jonathan Wolf, who I know you're good friends with all of them. I had a chance actually to chat with Vuo like before that drop, and he was so stoked on it. He was so hyped. And like, I think like he's got such a great energy around, you know, bringing my friends with me to like I love, you know, aspects of all their works. Let's see what we can do together. And I thought that was almost like a microcosm of some of that collaborative spirit that exists in the community. I know that was a big, moment for you and your career as an artist. And definitely, I would love to hear a little bit of how did that come together? And also, what was that day like, you know, that take us back to that drop?
I mean, it pretty much just happened out of the blue. Like, I talked with Fiwo a few times. We weren't like buddy buddies or anything like that. And we like hung out in VR once and just had a chat about life one day. And I was like, oh, this kid's cool. And, you know, it's hard to tell like how much of his online persona is a persona or how much of it is him and all that kind of stuff. But I talked with him for a few hours. And he was just like how I thought he'd be, super generous and awesome and kind and smart. And I remember walking away from that conversation like, damn, I'm really glad how successful Fiwo is, because he deserves it. I remember thinking that. And then a few weeks later, Fiwo hit me up on Twitter DMs and said, have you had a Nifty drop yet? I said, nope. I said, why? And then he was like, wait one sec. And then I was in a group chat with Tommy and Ashley from Nifty and Vivo and Jonathan and Odious. And I was just like, what? And and that was really before any of us knew each other. Like, Jonathan and Vivo do the podcast together. They're friends. But me and Odious didn't really know either of them that well or each other that well. So yeah, it really just came out of the blue. Fiwo just picked three artists who he felt that he wanted to work with and uplift, which was really cool. And yeah, so we worked on that. A few weeks after that, Fiwo moved to Seattle. He hit me up and he was like, I'm thinking about moving to Seattle. And I was like, cool, I got you. Here are the neighborhoods to like check out. Here are the blah, blah, blah. I was like, I'll pick you up from the airport if you want. You can crash at my house for a week while you get everything figured out. So that's what ended up happening, which I think was a really big help for the Nifty drop, because we were able to like stay up late in the night and joke around on the internet and like find all these crazy ideas of stuff to do, like the 3D printer and all that kind of stuff. So I think that was a big part of the success or just like the organic kind of joy that emanated from that process. So yeah, that was like a two months of Fiwo up here and all of us on Discord every day chatting, working on that project. And then the day of the project, I went and picked Fiwo up from Seattle. I live like a half hour south of Seattle, so drove back here to my spot and like got here like an hour before the drop, got on a call with Tommy and Ashley and Jonathan and Odious. Just like crazy amounts of excitement. We watched it happen live. The drawing for the actual collaboration that came with the physicals went live a half hour before the opens. And we were all really, really nervous about that. Leading up to this project, we were trying to price things super, super, super low, because we wanted it to be something that like everyone in the community could enjoy and participate in. But at the same time as we were trying to do that, Fiwo's pieces started selling for crazy amounts. Like the 2 weeks leading up to the drop, it went from like 40,000 as his highest sale to 250,000 and just like 2 weeks. And so, you know, we had some feedback from the Nifty team saying that if we price stuff too low, it will guarantee crash the entire site. It was like every day we were like bouncing back the prices and trying to figure something out. So the collab was the $44,000 piece, and we were all really, really nervous about how that would sell, because we couldn't even count, you know, how many collectors we'd think would participate in that. We were like, could count like 6 or 7 or 8 off the top of our heads who we thought would participate. So that was kind of nerve-wracking. But every time that drawing got entered, we were just like, oh, no way. And by the end of it, it got, I think, 34 entries out of the 15 collabs. So that went off without a hitch, really. And then, the Opens happened, and it's like a 5-minute window, you know? So like leading up to it, it's like all this anticipation. And then it's like 5 minutes, and we're all just like, for 5 minutes, and then it ends. Yeah, that was that. I wish I filmed the whole thing. We just have like a few little snippets from it. Definitely a wild day that I'll never forget. We ordered Indian food after that and had it delivered to the house.
Classic.
That best part of the story right there. That's what we'd like. The real stories on the NFT Now podcast.
Yeah, garlic naan or regular naan?
Garlic.
Yes!
That's the right answer. Right answer.
That's where it's at, man. Parrot, man, you mentioned something really, really wonderful that I want to touch on at the beginning of that story, that you guys met in VR, right? Yep. Like your first interaction. What do you think is the relationship between the metaverse and the real world, and specifically around artists? What do you think is going to have the effect of either curation, creation, or uplifting others?
I think the metaverse is like something that I think is still in such an infancy stage right now. It's like, even with like the platforms we have out there right now, the decentralized land and the different galleries in the metaverse, it's still like, what's so cool about it is there's so many people using it and buying land and you know, CryptoVoxels, Decentraland, setting up art galleries in these places, but there's also still so much room to grow. So when I look at it, I see the demand is there right now, and I'm really excited about how that's going to grow in the future. I think, I don't know. I don't know how many artists meet in the metaverse right now. I think Twitter, I don't know if you'd consider that the metaverse. I'm not sure what the overarching definition of the metaverse is, but I think Twitter is still like the biggest place where conversation happens. But I'd like to see that change, because when you do meet up in VR, whether it's like VR chat, CryptoVoxels, I don't know if that's VR. I know Sonium Space is VR, but you know, you meet up in a place like that and you can do activities together. I think that's the coolest part about the metaverse is it takes, like with Twitter, you just talk to people. And there can be like some events happening in Twitter, or at least conversation about events. But when you can hang out with someone and be like, look what I'm drawing in the air right now, or like, let's go check out this gallery over here and look at the same art at the same time together, I think that is where a real connection can happen. And I don't think it's quite to the place where, like, I don't know, like I try to get my friends into VR or this stuff, and it's still not quite to mass adoption levels yet, you know, but might be a good thing for us because that gives us like the early adapters badge.
Yeah, for sure. No, and I think it will be really interesting, because I think that when you think about art and going back to like the motivators of collectors, a lot of it is like people being able to some extent show off their collection, as egotistical Definitely. As it may be.
No, yeah.
As it stands, I mean, we'll see more and more different like platforms come to light where people will be able to like, right, and it's already exists to an extent, but to the extent that people will really be able to like engage and have like be able to interact and showcase their collection with other people in a virtual environment. Then even too, at that point, now it's just everything in the virtual environment itself is an NFT beyond just the art, right? Like now you just go like the clothes you're wearing, like, and now like NFT has literally just become like the infrastructure of scarce goods in this new environment. So that gets real exciting.
Yo, Parrot, do you own land in Decentraland?
I do not. I should have done that this summer when I saw it. Every time I look at it, I'm like, oh, too expensive. And then it's like every few weeks, it's a double in price.
We should build a compound together, you know, gather some funds, fucking buy a compound.
Yeah, no, it's probably not a bad idea. I mean, that's the thing about it, it is scarce. So like, it's going to keep going up in price.
Yeah, we'll get the NFT Now bunker soon enough. Just need a couple more subscribers, you know. Yo, so Parrot, I had I thought you touched on something really interesting earlier when you talked about how you were so stoked when that first work sold, just because it was something that you were already making for yourself on the side, mm-hmm. in addition to like client work and the like. And I think that really speaks to the experience that I think many artists, and digital artists specifically, are going through with this new technology, is that, you know, getting into this field, never expecting necessarily to be able to make a living, let alone mm-hmm. like, you know, the kind of money that we're seeing in the space, based on your own creative vision. because, you know, off the path of a digital artist is a lot, you know, previously has been supported by a lot of client work. And so mm-hmm. I'd love to hear about, like, you know, I'm sure that, you know, that for everyone who's been able to make that leap, and I'm really glad you have, because that's awesome. It's just awesome to see that kind of empowerment. But I'm sure there are so many artists who are really, who want to make that leap. And so I'd love to hear what advice you might have for artists who are looking to go from, like, that client work cycle of, like, you know, creating for clients and for brands and the like, to being able to build up sort of a sustainable community and meaningful income around their own NFTs and their own vision.
Yeah, advice. I don't know, because the space is changing so much. Like, the advice I would have given 3 months ago is completely different to the advice I'd give right now. I think that, I don't know. Yeah, when I came into this space, I basically, like, was like a year ago, I was like, I'm going to be broke for the rest of my life, but I'm going to be making art and be making music, and I'm totally cool with that. So this has been such a strange set of events that have happened up until now, where it's not like it was a planned thing. I think advice to other artists would be, don't look at NFTs as a cash grab, because I see a whole spectrum of, like, behavior from different artists. A lot of people coming to this scene organically and really excited about the technology behind this and kind of what the long-term play out will be in 5 years and 10 years to how this will change the metaverse and the digital landscape. I see other people coming in and just seeing the dollar signs that people are making and not necessarily understanding the hard work that they put into the scene, or the how early they were into the scene, or things like that. And they look at NFTs as a cash grab, in a sense, where they're like, cool, I'm just gonna do this and I'm gonna make a bunch of money off of my art. And, like, I see people who weren't artists before trying to make art to make money, which is such a weird weird change of tone from you know, how it used to be. And I do, you know, I'm glad that more people are making art. I think everyone can be creative, and the more artists, the better. But the main point of advice I'd give is to not rush things. Think about longevity. Learn about the community, who are the OGs, who are the people who have been doing this for a while. Look to them and see what they're doing, and respect the community, and add value to the community, not just take value from it.
I love that. I think those are really, really important words. And I love, the idea of adding value to the community is something that you've been doing regularly, even outside of just your artistry. You know, I follow Origin Stories with Roger. I think it's a great podcast. I think it's just, you know, like when you talk about ensuring that, like, credible voices and the OGs and, like, the people who have really given value to this community get heard, I mean, you both have done a great job of doing that. I'd just love to hear a little bit about, how did Origin Stories come together? How did you and Roger connect? And what's sort of in the works there? I know you guys have started doing your own, like, NFT collabs too. So I'd love to hear a bit about that.
Yeah, it was almost by chance how it happened. Me and Roger were DMing on Twitter a little bit, because we're both geeking out over this guy, Peter Moorbacher. Who's like an OG Magic the Gathering card illustrator and does this really cool, like, fantasy art. And I've been following him for, like, years now. And then we saw that he's had stuff on Maker's Place since, like, 2018 that was just kind of sitting there, not sold. Giannis also was talking about it on Twitter. I think that's how we found it. And me and Roger were DMing a little bit, just kind of geeking out over that dude's art. Stayed in touch a little bit. I got a really good vibe from Roger. Like, just based off of the little communication that we had, I was like, this dude seems to, like, really care about artists, really care about, like, integrity, and really, really care about, like, NFTs and the technology as a whole. So I got a really good vibe from him. He posted a tweet on Twitter saying, I'm looking for an artist for a project that I'm starting. DM me. And so I DM'd him, and he was like, you want to hear about this? I was like, yeah, tell me about it. And so we jumped on a Zoom call. And she was like, I want to start a podcast called Origin Stories. And it's going to be about, you know, all the artists in the scene and how, what their origins are, how they became an artist, how they came into NFTs. And so we just chatted and kind of talked for I don't know, 45 minutes or so, just talking about the ideas and stuff and getting a feel for each other. It was our first time really talking. And by the end of it, I was sold on it and he was sold on me being a part of it. And we started it pretty much right after that, maybe like a week later. And so Roger does like the long format interviews with one-on-ones with the artists. And then I do the live streams with him on Thursdays. And then I take care of the artsy stuff as well. We had like a specific idea for an NFT portion of it when it started, but now we're adapting to to how crazy everything's gone. So I know Roger right now has been neck deep in this humongous project that he's working on that ties in with origin stories and all this other stuff, but yeah, I probably can't talk too much about it, but it's going to be really, really cool.
Awesome, man. Well, as we kind of start to like round things, and you're already, I mean, putting on a lot of amazing like origin stories, but when you think about some of your favorite up and coming artists right now, who are some of them as you kind of come to a close?
I mean, the obvious, ferocious, odious, Jonathan Wolf. And I really like Christy Glass. Her stuff is really speaks to me. Defaced. He does really beautiful 2D work. He does really beautiful paintings. My boy Love Visuals does. He, when I first started doing 3D, he was like one of the only dudes who like pretty much took me under his wing and taught me a bunch of stuff. And also one of the only dudes who, that I, when I told people about NFTs like in June, one of the only people that listened to me got on board. My friend Connor Levitate, he makes one of the most talented and hardworking dudes I know. He makes crazy music and crazy visuals. He's on Super Rare and Maker's Place. And Kron4D, he does really cool AI stuff with GANs and neural networks, which is something that's always really interested me, AI and artificial intelligence, but I don't code. He does code. So we've been working on a project that kind of mixes our art together a little bit. And yeah, like a billion more people too. There's so many talented people in this space. And like, yeah, it's crazy. There's so many good artists, especially now coming in and even 6-8 months ago. If there's one thing that like NFTs in this whole space has done for me, it's widened my view of art and how much crazy cool art there is out there.
Hell yeah, man. I think it's actually just like opening up Pandora's box. Like the fact that now artists can create art for themselves and their communities, yeah, and not have to like sell their souls. So yeah. I think it'll only continue to get crazier, man. So
yeah.
So thanks to contributions and artwork like yours, man, for you coming onto the podcast today too, bro. So keep up the great work, man. Super grateful we were able to have you on, and we'll catch you in the metaverse, bro.
Yeah, yes, yeah. Sir.
Excited to see these projects in the works, especially that generative collab. I think that's like your style plus that is going to be really cool.
That's going to be really dope, bro. Appreciate you coming on, my man.
Yeah, for sure. Thanks for hosting, everyone.
All right, man. Cheers. Damn. Well, that was a great episode, man. Really enjoyed hearing what Parrot had to say. Excited for some of those drops that he's cooking up. And if you haven't already, definitely go check out his podcast, Origin Stories, as long as you stay subscribed to the NFT Now podcast, too. It's like it's a collaborative community, but don't forget about us. What'd you think, Matt?
I mean, I loved his perspective. You know, I as I said, I think that he is living what is a dream for many artists, which is to go from client work to being able to work with your friends and be able to have a career following your own creative vision. I think that he gives back in so many different ways. And I'm super excited to hear about some of these collaborations that he has in the works.
Yeah, 1,000%. Well, as always, everybody, thank you guys for tuning in. If you haven't already, please go ahead, drop a review wherever you listen to podcasts. Helps us grow and helps us get in front of more people. So, and on that note, we out. We'll be back next week. Peace.